Very good morning to everyone. Welcome back for the Geology Online lecture webinar. I'm Deepak Kumar Sahu, head of the department, KJ Somaiya College of Science and Commerce, Mumbai. Today's lecture is very special for everyone. And we have received more than 1500 registration for this lecture. Today's I don't need like any introduction for today's speaker, but it would be not fair if I don't introduce Biswal sir. So let me give a very brief introduction about Biswal sir. Biswal sir has awarded his master degree from IIT Kharagpur, and then he received his PhD from Rajasthan University. After his master's, he joined GSI, and he has given his valuable service for more than a decade in this prestigious institute. And then he joined IIT Bombay in 1994, if I'm not wrong, sir. He has a very big list of awards and honors. I will just mention a few of his awards and honors. He has been awarded 4 times as Excellence in Teaching by IIT Bombay. He is awarded with Best Paper of the Year in 1987 from Mineralogical Metallurgical Society of India. And he has published more than 50 research papers in various international and national journals. So I move to Biswal sir. It's an honor for me to present his lecture in this platform. Over to you, Biswal sir. Thank you so much for accepting our request for giving this webinar.
Thank you, Dr. Deepak. I congratulate you as well as your colleagues for arranging such talk, you know, and taking an initiative to arrange this type of webinars. Nowadays, you see, because of this pandemic, classes are not being held. So through online teaching or online seminar only, we can take classes, students can be benefited, the researchers can be benefited also. And this opens a new chapter, you know, where there will be interaction by email or by, there are several platforms where they can interact. So today I welcome you all. There are so many participants, as Yanada told me. There are several participants from different parts of the country, and they want to listen to this talk. I'm really privileged to have such a good gathering or good audience. So today we will be talking on tectonic evolution of the Aravallis. Now you can see this screen. I think I have shared my screen. So you might be thinking, why did I choose Aravallis, you know? Though I have worked in all terrains of India, right from Himalaya to Kanyakumari, but Aravallis is always close to my heart. Very frankly speaking, out of my 40-45 years of service in field of geology, the major part of it has gone on Aravallis. So Aravallis, in fact, you know, is my teacher. Though I have worked with many good geologists, good professors, but Aravallis has always become my teacher. Now you can see this slide. On the top left side, I have included the map of India, where you can see where is the Aravallis. So Aravallis is somewhere here. That pink part is Aravallis. So before we go to tectonics, you know, or the geology part of Aravallis, I will introduce to the area, the terrain, which is also equally interesting. Like the geology of Aravallis, the area, the landforms, the people, they are also equally interesting. So I will just talk a little about them. So let us go to the second slide. See, this is a Google imager, you know. I have downloaded and shown where is Aravalli. So you can
this
see.
This wall, sir, you can full screen your
full
presentation.
Screen. Okay. Okay. Now it is okay.
Thank you, sir. Yes, okay. Sir. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Now, this slide is very interesting in the sense it has many components. The center, I have kept the Google imagery of Aravalli. Now you can see these two yellow lines. These two yellow lines demarcate the boundary of Aravalli range or Aravalli mountain belt. You can see the North Delhi written somewhere, New Delhi written somewhere. So that is the Ganges alluvium. Ganges alluvium. So the western line, the western yellow line continues through that alluvium, you see, through Delhi to Haridwar and further north. So people believe, you know, this Aravalli mountain range once upon a time was continuing through this area, even to China. So now it is covered. Now it is covered by this Indo-Ganges alluvium, then Himalayan mountain belt has destroyed it. So there are some outcrops in China. Otherwise, it is confined to the state Rajasthan, Himachal Pradesh, Gujarat, mostly Rajasthan. So the northern part we'll forget. Only we'll be discussing mostly from the Rajasthan. Now see, along with this, I'll show you some places, you know, which is there. You can see New Delhi. Then you can see Udaipur, Chittor. These are very important places I will be referring. Then you can see Jaipur. Jaipur is there. Here is Mount Abu, Ambaji. Then this side is your Mewar Bundelkhand Craton. These lines are lines represent the Vindhyans. And this side, the Western Thar Desert, which is represented by Marwar Craton. So on the west, you have Marwar Craton. On the east, you have Mewar Bundelkhand Craton. So this is the linear Delhi Aravalli mountain belt, or you say Aravallis, whatever you say. Now, this part, the central part, is just the state of Rajasthan. That means the Rajasthan covers major part of Aravalli. Now this part, see, I have kept few photographs, you know. Why Aravalli is so close to me? Just to justify that, I have kept few photographs. Now see, in the east, in the top right side corner, and camel, you know. Camel is the major carrier, domesticated animal here, major carrier. So sometimes you visit Rajasthan, you should enjoy riding a camel. Nothing like that. The horse is very fast. The donkey is very slow. But camel is intermediate, you know. It can run, it can move very slowly. You will enjoy a camel riding if you go to Rajasthan. So that is the greatest attraction of Rajasthan. Now, next you come to the peacocks. Peacocks moves very freely. They have no fear. They will come to you. When you do field work, they will come to you. If you have some grains with you, you can throw before them. They will enjoy. So they always enjoy, you know, when you visit in group. If you are doing field work in group, they also come in group and enjoy your group. They are absolutely fearless. So similarly, if you go to the top left corner, you will find many black box, the black deer. So that is very attractive. They don't come to you, of course. They run away. But they are very good looking. Very good looking. And very safe. Nobody harms them. See, the reason is the people in this area are so good. Even the animals like this, they freely move. So this is the first point. Why I like Rajasthan, you know. You go to Rajasthan for field work, you will get a very hospitable terrain, hospitable surrounding. People will welcome you. They're absolutely harmless. You can go to any part of their area, territory, and do your field work. And since this is a desertic terrain, the outcrops are plenty. 100% preservation of outcrops. So you can go any place. Go to their fenced areas. Go to their well section. Go to very close to their house to take some readings. They will not mind. They are very hospitable, very friendly. Now, you will also enjoy their festivals. You know, if you are doing field work and staying in some of the villages, you will enjoy their festivals. You can see a photograph, you know. Some of our students, they are participating in their festival. And if you go to the right side, bottom corner, you see the group of students which are doing field work. So these students belong to IIT Bhubaneswar. So earlier I was taking IIT Bombay students for field work. And then sometimes I did with IIT Bhubaneswar students. So field work is really enjoyable. So this is how the Rajasthan is so good for field work. And you know, Rajasthan is also quite very famous. Very famous. Now, Rajasthan is known for bravery, for architecture. If you go to Jaipur, you will see so many buildings, so many palaces. Udaipur Palace, if you go and see, you will be just thrilled. Chittorgarh, you will be just thrilled. Now, you must know now, you must know something different, you know. The Udaipur area is known as Mewar. Udaipur area, this area is known as Mewar. Jaipur area is known as Mewar-e. Meruar-e. Jaipur area is known as Meruar-e. And this western side, Pali, that is called Marwar. That is why it is called Marwar Traton. And this side, the Udaipur side, it is called Mewar, so it is called Mewar Traton. Now, Mewar is very famous. You must have heard about Rana Pratap Singh. So he is from this Udaipur and Chittorgarh area. So the Indian center bravery history, if suppose somebody writes, Rana Pratap Singh comes first, Jhansi comes next. Like this, you know, there are so many bravery stories of braveries, and Rana Pratap Singh stands first. You must have remembered the Haldi Ghat. So they all occurs very close to Udaipur. So we have enjoyed those areas, you know, we have seen those areas. And recently, or you must have heard about Rani Padmavati. Rani Padmavati story, who does not know? Dohrata hun, suno rakta se likhi hui kurvani, jiske karan mitti bhi chandan hai Rajasthan. So this poem just thrills you, fills your heart, you know, the bravery of these Rajasthani peoples. They are very brave. They can fight to their death. Same time also, they are quite hospitable. If you go to those areas, they will welcome you like anything. So because of this nature, you know, the friendly nature of Rajasthan and complete outcrop, preservation of complete outcrops, many geologists have gone to Rajasthan for field work. They spend their lifetime in Rajasthan. Now, I have written few names like Hackett, Middlemiss, Heron, Raja Rao, Naha, Professor Naha, Professor Gangopada, Professor Mukhopadhyay, Gupta, Professor A.V. Roy, and many others. The Jaipur University, Udaipur University people, they're still working. Professor Pandit, Professor K.K. Sharma, Professor Purohit. There are many people who are working, still working in the Rajasthan and finding very new observations. Nowadays, many new technologies and new techniques have come up, particularly in geochronology, particularly in geochemistry. So the Delhi-Aravalli Mobile Belt has provided a great opportunity to the students, the research scholars, to find new things. Which other parts of India are not to that extent. So, We will discuss this Delhi-Arabali mobile belt or Arabali's tectonics in a very nutshell, because I have been given, say, 1 hour time. So in that, you know, we have to cover many things. But many of my class notes are available in YouTube. You can see Rajasthan geology. Very detailed I have discussed with the students. And as you know, because all of us, including me also, has gone through a student phase. The teaching in the classroom is different from giving a talk or giving a seminar before an audience. So you can see those YouTube lecturers, and if you have any doubt also, you can ask me. No problem. Now let us go to the next slide. Yeah. So this slide, you know, is very important slide. This slide belongs to Heron's time, 1950s. The right side you are seeing the Heron's original map, which I have drawn in Coral Draw. I have simplified. But you see the map prepared by the Geological Survey of India. How detailed map they have prepared. Okay, it is so neatly drawn and very small, small letters are there. So I thought, if I want to show something to the students, let me just redraw it. So I'll discuss this left side map, the colored map. So this is the map prepared by Heron. So Heron worked in a time, you know, when there was no dating facility. Geochronological facility was not there. So he is a person who believes only field work, field mapping. So the type of work he has done is on non-matching, on non-parallel till today. We also work in Aravallis, but the type of observation and type of mapping, the techniques he has adopted, there is no matching with that. Now, if you see this map, you know, this colored map, you can see very prominently, you know, a green patch. Green patch, can you see? Yes. So this green patch is called Aravalli system. Aravalli system. It is Heron's map. Why I am discussing Heron's map? Because unless you understand this, the recent map you cannot follow. What changes has been made in the recent map? What revisions has been made recently? You cannot understand. Now, why they have done, what is the logic behind it, you cannot understand. So, what Heron has done, see this green color one is called Aravalli system. Now, attached to this Aravalli system, this pink color one is called Banded Gneissic complex. Banded Gneissic complex is a very migmatitic rock. But Aravallis are generally low grade rocks with some marble bands here and there. So this Aravallis and this Banded Gneissic complex, that is the Archean component, or Archean rocks, Archean crust. This is what Heron thought. So in the stratigraphy column, in the index bus, you can see Beras granite, BGC, Aravalli system. This are called Archean. Why he said it is Archean? Because of two reasons. One is this migmatites of BGC. And the other one is this low grade rocks. Aravallis are the very low grade rocks. Sometimes you will find there is no metamorphism. Because of this reason, he said it is Archean. There was no age with him. They are on fossiliferous. But he said these are probably Archean. Now, then you see the yellow colored rocks. Yellow colored unit, he said it is Delhi's. So Delhi's are occurring in a linear belt, you see, from Ambaji, goes straight to Ajmer. Then further north, you know, Khetri, Jaipur, north area. So this totally is the Delhi system. Now, if you go to the west of Delhi system, you will find again, you know, a strip of pink color rocks. That is according to him also BGC, Banded Gneissic complex. And there is a green color strip near Sirohi. That is Aravallis. So this is how he mapped. He saw the Aravalli mountain range. So according to him, what he said, the entire Aravalli mountain range forms a synclinarium, a large scale syncline. The center part of this incline is your Delhi rocks, the youngest one, followed by these Aravallis, green color rocks. So on either side you will find green color rocks, so Aravallis. Then you have banded gneissic complex further away from the core. That is how he visualized this entire Aravalli mountain is the synclinarium. This is the region. And in this synclinarium, which is the Archean component? The banded gneissic complex and the Aravalli system. They are Archean. And Delhi is protrogenic. Along with that, he has shown some Erinpura granite and Malani rhyolite. Erinpura granite is extensive granitic plutonism on the western side of Aravallis, very close to Delhi rocks, and in the further west, Erinpura granite is occurring. And Malanis, there are some violet color rocks, these are called Malanis. Yeah. So this is how Heron visualized the Rajasthan geology. It was accepted, you know, for a long time. So this map was published something around 1953. First challenge came to this map, you know, in 1960s or even later, 1970s, when people started dating the rocks. What is dating the rocks? Now the mass specs have developed. So rubidium, strontium, isotope, mass spec. So all those things were used to date a rock. What is the absolute age of these rocks? Whether it is 1000 million year or 2000 million year, 3000 million year. So that advantage, you know, the geologists of Rajasthan or Aravalli geologists got it. Particularly Geological Survey of India started this dating of the rocks sometimes in 1975. Crawford, they invited Crawford to date these rocks. Naturally, when you date a rock, so you know whether he is at his 16 or he is at 16. But by looking at hair, you cannot say, na? So those changes came. So what changes has been made? Let us go and see in the next slide. Yeah. So left side, I am showing you 1953 map, Heron. Why I am still showing this map, you know? You see how meticulously he has mapped. Meticulously means he has almost traveled every spot of Aravalli mountain. That means he's a geologist. He was the director. He was the director of Western Region. So he has moved with his geologist to every nook and corner of Rajasthan. So he has prepared this map with very, very meticulous observations. Conglomerate beds, small limestone beds, faults, and what not. By observing the map, you can see how sincere he was in the field. Now, to the east, this side, you know, right side, the revised map. The revised map I am showing, this was published in 1980. How this was published? This was published on the basis of this radiometric dating. Whatever Heron was telling, Aravalli system belonging to Archean age, is it like that? Whatever Heron was telling, the Aravalli is occurring on the western part of, are they really Aravallis? So all those questions were solved, you know, by dating the rocks, particularly the granites, which are intruding those different formations. So they dated those granites and found the age of those rocks. So this was really a challenge because these isotopic systems, you know, they are also getting improvements. Initially they did with rubidium, strontium, then zircon came, then monazite dating, so many various ways of dating the rocks. still people are improving them. But now to some extent, you know, these dating methods have been stabilized and we have a robust edges of different formations, and our understanding about Arabuli geology is more or less improved. I will not say it is complete, it is quite improved. Now, what changes were made, I will tell you. I'll just go back to Heron's map first, then I will come here. So then you will understand. This map I will show you again. See, this map you are seeing, the Heron map. The first changes they have made, you know, you see this Aravallis, which is called Udaipur Aravallis. Udaipur is here. This green color, this is called Hindoli Aravallis. Hindoli Aravallis, this is Udaipur Aravallis. Now, there is a granite called Beras granite. Beras is written here, Beras granite. Beras granite. Now, this Beras granite, there was a gentleman called C.S. Rajarao. He was a GSI geologist. Later he became director. He was a fantastic field geologist. Now, he was working in Beras. It is very close to Chittoregarh. There is a Beras river. So he was working in the Beras granite area. So what he found Beras granite, the Beras granite has intruded these Aravalli. These Aravalli, you know, there are some Beras granite offshoots which is intruding this Udaipur. This Beras granite, this Beras granite is intruding into this Hindoli Aravallis. This Hindoli Aravalli, you see this green color. This Beras granite is intruding into it. You can see the contact metamorphism. You can see the minor offshoots of Beras granite into the foliations of Hindoli. It is intruding. Whereas this Beras granite, if you come towards south, he found the Beras granite forming a basement for this Aravallis. Basement means what? The Beras granite is there, over which the Aravalli sediments are sitting with the erosional amkan permitting. You understood my point, na? So Beras granite is intruding into Hindoli. Beras granite is a basement for this, to Udaipur Aravallis. Then he said, these two Aravallis are not same. Hindoli Aravallis cannot be same as Udaipur Aravallis. That is the first deviation, he said. The Heron has told everything is Aravalli and Archean is. Hindoli, Udaipur Aravallis are Aravallis only. But he said, no, Hindoli Aravallis are older because Beras granite is intruding. And Udaipur Aravallis are younger. Why? Because Beras granite is forming the basement. It is occurring below. So he said these two Aravallis has to be different. Hindoli Aravallis are older and Udaipur Aravallis are younger. That made revolutionized the ideas, you know. Aravallis are not a single Aravalli. These are two different Aravallis. Then this Beras granite was dated by rubidium strontium methods. Crawford dated, and subsequently many people dated, and it was found 2.6 billion years. Remember this, yes. 2.6 is a very, very remarkable time when Archean period, you know, was over and Proterozoic started. So during that period, Beras granite intruded into Aravallis. Not only in the Aravallis, several places in India you will find 2.6 billion year is a period of several granitic plutonism. Close plate granite, Dharwar granite, Bastar granite, several places you will find 2.6 million year there are several granitic intrusions, marking the transition from Archean to Proterozoic. So this Beras granite was intruding Hindoli. So Hindoli become older than 2.6. So Archean. Whereas Aravallis, Udaipur Aravallis are younger than Beras, younger than 2.6. So they become Paleoproterozoic. We are not same. In between you have Beras granite. So that is the first revision that Aravalli geology was made. There are two Aravallis. One is Udaipur Aravallis and a Hindoli Aravallis. Hindoli Aravallis is Archean and Udaipur Aravallis is Paleoproterozoic. So this gives a new dimension to Aravalli geology. So many such granites were dated. So like another thing, what happened, you know? See, you come to the western side, this banded gneissic complex are shown on the western side near Sirohi. And Aravalli is shown at Sirohi. Those rocks were dated. Heron has told them these are Archeans. But it was found new Proterozoic. So all these BGC rocks which you see here, you know, pink color rocks, they are all 900, 800 million years. So they are all Neoproterozoic. This Aravalli, which has been shown here near Sirohi, they are all Neoproterozoic. 820, 750, like this ages came. Because now you have got an instrument to date them. There is no ambiguity. So what happened? Now this western side, whatever banded gneissic complex or Aravalli were shown by Heron, you know, they are all clogged within the Neoproterozoic and equated with this Aravalli, with the Dellies. Dellies and all these rocks are of similar Neoproterozoic age. So Aravalli is now two different components. Udaipur Aravalli is Paleoproterozoic. Hindoli Aravalli is Archean. Now the banded gneissic complex, which you see here, you know, this is called BGC 2, this is called BGC 1. So several ages came. And oldest of them was this part. Near Udaipur, whatever banded gneissic complex is seen, they are the oldest, 3.5 billion years. Whereas this banded gneissic complex was found to be 2.8 billion years. So like this, the ages, you know, gave a new innovative thinking about the geology of Rajasthan. That is how a new map was necessary and new map was given by Geological Survey of India. So the second, next slide you see. So what he said, now here how you will start. This is a very complicated map. But if you sit with someone, you know, he will explain. Now, you see the Aravallis. Aravallis are here. Aravallis. Paleoproterozoic Aravallis. Yeah. Only near Udaipur. Udaipur. Now, you see this red color one. Red color one. These are the Archeans. This BGC one. These Hindoli Aravallis, all included in Archean. And this is called Dhilwada Supergroup, the red color one, Dhilwada Supergroup. This is Dhilwada Supergroup, which is Archean. This is Aravalli Supergroup, which is Paleoproterozoic. And then there is a called Sendmata. Sendmata granulite complex here. So though this shows some Mesoproterozoic age, but it is included in Bhilwara. Included in Bhilwara. Why? Because the country rock shows 2.8 billion year age. This country rock. But there are some granulite enclaves or granulite plutons inside this country rock, which gives 1.7 billion year. So mixed rock, mixed edges. You have 1.7 granulites, but the country rock is 2.8. So this Sanmata complex, where the granulites are there, that is also included in Bhilwara. So what is Bhilwara now? Bhilwara is BGC1. Then this Hindoli Aravallis, which is called also Mangalwada complex. And this Sanmata complex. All these are included in Bhilwara supergroup. So here this stratigraphic column is there where Bhilwara supergroup is written. So you can see Mangalwada complex, Sanmata complex, Hindoli group, like this, you know. They coined a separate supergroup called Bhilwara supergroup, which belongs to Archaea. Now, Aravallis only remain near Udaipur and south of Udaipur. This is Udaipur. So, this is the only Aravalli paleoprotology. It is no Archaean age now. Then, this blue color, right from Ajmer down south to Ambaji, Mount Abu, these are Delhis. Within Delhis, there are so many places you will find granite intrusions. Granite intrusions. They have different names. Ambaji granite, Sendra granite is here. Basic intrusions, which they said fullard ophiolites. That is there. So, further west if you go, this is Sirohi group of rocks. Sirohi group of rocks, generally people, according to GSI, the Sirohi group of rocks were included inside the Delhi supergroup. It is not a separate supergroup. They included in Delhi supergroup. So together, the Sirohi group of rocks are within the Delhi supergroup. So like this, the Rajasthan geology, which was considered to be forming a synclinarium, is no longer a synclinarium. They have separate terrains or separate entities. Bhilwara occurring in the east, Archaean age, then Aravalli paleoprotozoic in the south, that is another entity, another unit. Then neoprotozoic unit, Delhi and Sirohi, neoprotozoic units. So you have basically three units. One is Bhilwara unit, Bhilwara supergroup. Then you have Aravalli unit, Aravalli supergroup. Then Delhi unit, Delhi supergroup. So this is how the Aravalli geology becomes different now, distinct now. Now, I'll go back to Aran's map again. So there are some patches of Delhi here in the northern part near Jaipur. So these Jaipur patches, earlier they were included in Delhis. So these North Delhis, they are not same as South Delhis. The main Delhi which you see on the western side, they are not same. So there are some edges from the North Delhi, they are equivalent to this Aravallis, Udaipur Aravallis. So their age is something around 2 million years. Paleoprotozoic age. So North Delhi is no longer a part of Delhis. So now they have been splitted to South Delhi and North Delhi. North Delhi. So North Delhi has been now older than the South Delhi. Okay. So now let us go to, So this is how the geology has been divided. But point is, after finding these edges, you know, the people started thinking the evolution of Aravalli mountain belt or Aravalli range, you know, in terms of plate tectonics. Plate tectonics. So how do they divide that? How do they divide that? Just a minute. Yeah. Yeah. Now, you see, I'll go back to further back, you know. Just a minute. Yeah. I'll just go a little back. This map, I am again coming back. Now you see, this is Delhi Aravalli mobile belt. This is Aravalli Delhi mobile belt. Just now you see the Mewar and Bundelkhand craton occurs in the east, and the Marwar craton occurs in the west. So what is the plate tectonic they are considering now? Probably this Delhi Aravalli mobile belt was developed because of collision between Mewar Bundelkhand craton and the Marwar craton. So these two cratons were collided and gave rise to Delhi Aravalli mobile belt. Now this collision, you know, didn't take place in one go. So in three different periods, this collision has taken place. So there's a Bhilwara orogenic cycle, Aravalli orogenic cycle, then Delhi orogenic cycle. Three at least distinct orogenic cycles are there. One is Archean period, which is called Bhilwara orogenic cycle. Then one Paleoproterozoic period, that is Aravalli orogenic cycle, and Neoproterozoic period, that is called Delhi orogenic cycle. Now, this is how this has been visualized nowadays in terms of plate tectonics. Now, I will go to here. Now, see, this is your Bhilwara group of rocks, Bhilwara group of rocks or Bhilwara supergroup. Now, you can see here is the great boundary fault. Great boundary fault is here. Now, probably the subduction along this great boundary fault. Great boundary fault, nowadays you can see as a fault, brittle deformation features. But during Archean time, it was a suture. The Bundelkhand craton, which was this side, subducted under Mewar craton. Mewar craton, the entire thing was Mewar craton. So this subducted, giving rise to this. Beraj granites, then Untala granites, those granites were produced because of the subduction. So this is the Bhilwara orogenic cycle. The Hinduli groups were deformed. The migmatization took place. All these things happened during Archean period. Then what happened? Then Aravalli supergroup was developed. Aravalli rocks were deposited because of rifting. This entire thing was Mewar craton. This side total was Marwar craton. So in the Marwar craton, this Aravalli group developed. Aravalli supergroup rocks were deposited. Then along this Rakhabdev lineament, the subduction took place from east. So this Bundelkhand plus this Bhilwara together, you know, they subducted and formed this Aravalli orogen. So Aravalli rocks were deformed. Then Rakhabdev ophiolites were abducted. So this is Aravalli orogenic cycle. Then after that, then Delhi basin formed during Mesoproterozoic period. So rifting took place, deposition happened. So this now Bundelkhand plus Bhilwara plus Aravalli together subducted. So along which there was Kali-Guman lineament. There is Kali-Guman lineament here. Along the Kali-Guman lineament subduction happened towards west. So Delhi deformation took place. Lot of folds, metamorphism, all these things happened. So this is new Proterozoic cycle. So during this period, all this granite intrusion Ambaji granite, Sevaria granite, here Sevaria batholith is there. All those granites were intruded during Delhi erosion. Erimpura granite. So they intruded. So this is how the subduction followed by opening, then again subduction followed by opening. So typical Wilson cycle operated in Aravalli Mountain. So initially it was a single craton during Archean time. Bundelkhand, Marwad, all together, you know, they were forming a single craton. So Bundelkhand first subducted along this great boundary fault. Great boundary fault you are seeing today, but that time it was a suture. So this Beraj granite, Beraj granite developed. So Beraj granite age is 2.6. So this subduction is somewhere around 2.6. So deformation in this Hindoli group took place, the pigmentization took place, then extension took place, forming the Aravalli basin. Then Aravalli subduction took place along this Rakhapdev lineament. So that subduction is something around 1.8 billion year time. Delhi orogenic cycle, the subduction took place around 1.8-1.7 billion year period. So during this subduction, what happened? The Senmata granulites, they were intruded. Senmata granulite is 1.7 billion years. Then what happened? Then the Delhi basin developed. Delhi basin developed by extension, by rifting. So Delhi basin and Sirohi basin, they developed almost at the same time. Now, when this extension took place, some granites were intruded into Delhi basin. You must have heard about the extensional granites. So one of them is Chandra granites, which shows an age of 1 billion years. Chandra granite. So probably this extension and rifting of Delhi basin was taking place during that period. But Delhi subduction took place somewhere around 860 million years. How could this was known? This was known from this Ambaji granite, from the Sevaria granites. They are seen kinematic to Delhi deformation, Delhi folding and metamorphism. Sevaria and Ambaji. So they give an age of 860 to 880 million years. So probably Delhi erosion took place around 880 million years. And Sirohi erosion or Sirohi Delhi together, it has happened around 850, 860 million years. So that is how three orogenic cycle has gone through or passed over the Aravalli mountain range. So Bhilwara orogeny somewhere around 2.6 when Beraj granite intruded. Then Aravalli orogeny when this Rakhapdev lineament developed. Senmata granulites were intruded. That is somewhere around 1.7 to 1.8 billion years. Then Delhi orogeny. When the Chandra granite, Ambaji granite took place, Sevaria granite intrusion took place, Erimpura granite intrusion took place. So that is something around 880 to 860 million years. So these are the three distinct periods, orogenic periods in Aravalli Mountain. Now many people say, you know, the controversy. Because always we see the our orogeny should be equivalent to the global orogeny. The global orogeny is, you must have heard the name of Greenvillian orogeny, which took place around 1 billion year time. Columbia orogeny 1.7 and 1.8 billion year time. So many people see in terms of those global orogenies. One contrasting view, you know, which I also propagate, the Delhi orogeny. Delhi orogeny, we say it is part of Pan-African orogeny. Some people say, no, it is part of Greenvillian orogeny. Greenvillian orogeny is 1 million year time, 1 billion year time. Pan-African orogeny, in fact, you know, has a very long life. Right from 0.9 billion year, that means 900 million year, to 0.5, and 500 million year, 900 to 500 million year. It is very long life. Our Delhi orogeny, we are finding the age of Ambaji granite and Sevaria granite to be something around 860, 870. So it is part of Pan-African only. But many people say, you know, from other observations, no, it is Rhodinia, which is 1 billion year. So this is, there is a contrasting in views. But this contrast, this discussion and difference in opinion will always exist. So now I will go to next slide. You see. So these are some of the deformation features which you will find in Aravallis. Why I am showing all these field photographs, you know. See, many times I always advocate in the class, you know, however good you may be in structural geology, you may be writing many good papers, very good models, but unless you understand field geology, you cannot be a complete field geologist or complete structural geologist. See, these structural structures which you find in Aravallis, this type of preservation you will not get in any other field. Right from Himalaya to Kanyakumari, you move around, because I have seen personally, Aravalli is the best. You see this type 3 interference pattern. Now this is, as you know, it is a coaxial folding or hook pattern it is called. So this is F1 fold, then F2 fold. So why I'm showing this thing, both the folds you have to see, because unless you see both the folds together, you cannot describe this interference pattern. By observing one fold, you cannot describe the interference pattern. But these type of preservations are there in Aravalli Mountain. Almost everywhere, right from Ambaji to Ajmer, you will get these features. Very accurately preserved. So that means you can say there is a coaxial folding in the Aravalli Mountain. Next is, you see, a textbook style mirror image pattern. So this is F1, this is F2. Textbook style mirror image pattern. Probably you will find in the Ramsey's book only a photograph of this type. So Aravalli is a mess with those observations made by Ramsey. You see next one, dome and basin features. You see the basins. Basins are very characteristic. You see the basins. This is one basin, this is another basin. Here is a basin. Here. So these are the domes, you know, where the small granitic outcrops have come up. Here is a dome. So these dome and basin patterns are very clearly preserved with Aravalli. So from this interference pattern, you can understand how many types or how many generations of folds are there, how many deformational fabrics are there. F1 fabric, F2 fabric. F1 fabric is the axial planar fabric. Now let us go back to, you see, the F1 fold, the axial plane cleavage or axial plane systocity is called axial planar or F1 fabric. But F2, you will get a crenulation fabric. Crenulation fabric. Similarly, F3, F4 folds are there. So corresponding to those folds, you will find the deformation fabrics. So if you understand those deformation fabrics, then you can understand the tectonics. So it is very important, you know, to identify those features and understand those fabrics. You may have to take use of or make use of the microscope, whether it is a F1 fabric or S1 fabric, whether it is a F2 or S2 fabric. Those things can be verified under microscope. Now you see these features. This is the intersection lineation. Intersection between bedding and S1 fabric gives rise to this intersection lineation. Those who are working in Aravalli Mountain, they will get in plenty. Because there is no erosion, there is no rainfall. So these things are preserved so nicely. But if you go to South India or even to Eastern Ghats, first of all, though, you will not find outcrops. Secondly, to preserve this type of corrugated outcrop, you know. Corrugated outcrop, you will not find anywhere excellently preserved in Rajasthan. So if you want to learn structural geology, field geology, you should choose always Aravalli Mountain. Now next photograph you see, beautiful fold. You see the buddings in the limb region of the fold. Buddings, can you see these buddings? The buddings indicate the competent layers, which has been stressed to form the buddings. And you can see the axial planar fabric parallel to axial plane of the fold. These are the S1 fabric. Now, you see, the pegmatite veins have intruded a marble and refolded, buddinas as well as refolded. What the title I have written, wavelength thickness. That means depending on the thickness of the layer, you will find folds of different wavelength. Now this layer is very thick. So you will find large wavelength fold. And this layer is very thin. You will find small wavelength fold. So like this, you know, the entire structural geology we read in the Ramsey's book or Davies books, even Professor Ghose books, you will find as it is in the Aravalli Mountain. So learning structural geology, and here you see, there are perfect preservation of the shear zones. Shear zones are perfectly preserved. You can see the clasts, sigmoidal clasts. It's in the field itself, you can know the sense of shear. SC fabric, you can know the sense of shear. In the field itself, you need not have to collect a oriented sample, bring back to your laboratory, cut it very perfectly. In the field itself, you can know. And the rocks are so well preserved. That is the attractive part of Aravalli. Here I have shown many photographs to just say that how beautiful it is in Aravalli. You see the first photograph, pre-F1 granite. Granite has been refolded by F1 fold. That means this granite was before F1. Now if you date this granite, this will tell you the age of F1 fold, because F1 fold has to be younger than this. That is how we have done it. That is why we have done it. So now a gentleman who is standing is Yankam Singh. He is now in IIT Bhubaneswar. Now, here you see, a granite is intersecting another granite. These two granites we dated, they show different ages. This granite, it is showing 840. This granite, it is showing 750. And this granite is 860 million years. So like this, from the granites, you know, their ages, you can determine when the folding has taken place. Foldings are the major features of orogeny, you know? Delhi orogeny, Aravalli orogeny. We just identify the granites and their relationship with the structure. So you can know when these structures were developed. Similarly, here you see a granite where magmatic fabrics are developed. The alkali feldspars, they are arranged in a particular fashion. They are magmatic fabric. Here you see, there are some spherulites, rounded structures, you know, in metavolcanics. So these are extensively used, you know, for strain analysis. So during deformation, what is this strain? Flattening strain, constriction strain, plane strain, all those analyses can be done because the features are so well preserved. So now, what I wanted to say, that the features are so well preserved, you should have a well-trained mind, how to approach. And you should be very sincere, you know, to map the area, to go to each and every spot, which Aravalli Range provides you. There is no wild animal. The people are so hospitable. The terrain is so friendly. What else you want? So you can learn perfect geology, you know, if you work in Aravalli. Okay. Now, this is the tectonic evolution model, you know. I have done it. Whatever we have discussed, you know, that I have included inside these 6 models. So thanks to one of my students, you know, who prepared it. Now you see, the first one, number 1. This is showing Archean crust. Archean crust. So that means northwestern India was a extensive craton. So you have Marwar craton. Other side you have Bundelkhand craton or Mewar craton. This side. And there are many patches, you know, of gneisses. You see Anasagar granite gneiss, 2.8 billion year. Bewar gneiss, 2.8 billion year. Mangalwar, 2.8. Untala granite, 3.5. So you have a 2.8 to 3.5 GA or billion year Archean crust in the northwestern India. So on the west you have Marwar craton. In the east you have Bundelkhand and Mewar craton. This is how the cratons were distributed in northwestern India. So the age is 2.8 to 3.5 billion years. Now come to the second. What is the second figure it is showing? The Bundelkhand is subducting under the rest of the craton. You can say the Mewar craton. The Marwar craton, which is in the west, Marwar, which is remaining in the west, that is the overriding plate, and this is the undergoing plate, subducting plate, Bundelkhand. So when the subduction took place around 2.5 to 2.6 billion year, you see this melted the rock. The granites were emplaced. As you know, during subduction, the granites are generated by melting of the rocks, so they are produced. So those granites tell you what is the age of subduction. So what is the age of subduction? The Beras granite is 2.5, the Gingla granite is 2.5, Jiri granite, this is North Delhi terrain, Jiri granite. So Jiri granite is 2.5 to 2.6 billion year. So that is the period when the Bundelkhand craton was subducted. So this is your Bhilwara orogenic cycle. This is called Bhilwara orogenic cycle. Now come to third. So Bhilwara orogenic cycle ended. Now whole thing, you know, you see Beras granite and other things, you know, they become stratonized. They become stable. When it becomes stable, you see the Aravalli basin developed. Aravalli basin developed by rifting. By rifting, the Aravalli basin developed. North Delhi basin developed. So these are demarcated by this rifting symbol, extension symbol. Now because of this extension, these basins were developed and the sediments were deposited. So the Aravalli and North Delhi terrains, you know, North Delhi areas, they were considered to be the around 2.2 GA. So these basins developed. Now come to fourth diagram. The Aravalli subduction took place around 1.8 to 1.7 GA. During this period, the subduction took place. So Rakhapdev ophiolites were abducted, then North Delhi basin closed. So this subduction is called Aravalli subduction, somewhere around 1.8 to 1.7 GA. Now this part becomes catonized. It becomes a single unit. Again, the rifting took place. Rifting took place. When the rifting took place, somewhere around 1 billion year, the Delhi basin developed. So these are the indications. The rifting is the indication of basin formation. So sometimes, you know, you must be knowing that how a basin develops. Generally, we say because of extension. So extension has two different models, you know. One is a simple shear model, another is a pure shear model. Sometimes you should refer these things, you know. What is simple shear model? Now, when you stress something, it is not that symmetrically Horst and Gravens develops. A very big shear zone develops, inclined to one side. Inclined to one side, one shear zone develops. And accordingly, the extension takes place. So there is a Wernick, there is a paper by Wernick, extension and formation of the basins by Wernick, Wernick model. So you should follow that book, Wernick, W-E-R-N-I-C-K. So he has followed a simple shear model for the basin developments. So we sometimes feel that these basins are developed because of the simple shear deformation. So Delhi basin, Delhi Sirohi basin together, they developed here, Delhi Sirohi basin. So this is somewhere around 1 GA. Now the Delhi basin closed. Delhi basin closed when around 860 million years. I was telling the Ambaji granite was intruded, then Sevore granite intruded. So that marks, that demarcates the Delhi orogeny. So Delhi orogeny took place around 860 million years. So Delhi and Sirohi, you cannot distinguish them to be different orogenies, same orogeny. So now, this probably this is your Pan-African orogeny belonging to the early part of Pan-African orogeny. Many people say it is Rhodymia, but somehow I personally and some of my students, we believe it is Pan-African. Pan-African orogeny has two parts. The early part is somewhere around 900, 850, 860. And late part is 600 to 500. The 600 to 500, you know, that part of Pan-African orogeny you will see in Madagascar, southern India. But the early part, 900 to 850, you will find in East African origin, Arabian shield areas. So our part, Delhi orogeny, probably belongs to that Nubian, Arabian shield areas, equivalent to that. But many people say, no, no, it is part of Rhodymia orogeny. So this type of controversies still exists as far as Delhi orogeny is concerned. So how I will summarize? I will summarize that the Aravalli mountain has undergone three phases of orogenic cycles. One is your Bhilwara orogeny, the second picture. Next is Aravalli orogeny, fourth picture. Then Delhi orogeny, the sixth picture. All together, they have given rise to your Aravalli Delhi mobile belt or Aravalli mountain belts, Aravalli orogen. You can give different names. Orogen, orogeny, what is the difference? Orogeny is a process. And orogen is the product. So Aravalli orogen is the product of three orogenies. Bhilwara orogeny, Aravalli orogeny, and Delhi orogeny. So this is how the tectonic evolutions of Aravalli mountain range is discussed. So we have published many papers. So you can just refer them or my YouTube videos. Okay. Now, our last picture is this. Live peacefully. Work very hard. That is the message, you know, this picture gives us. Live peacefully. And Rajasthan is an example. Sometimes you visit Rajasthan, see the architectures of Udaipur, Jaipur, Mount Abu, you will find a lot of serenity in it. Very good lakes. Udaipur is a city of lakes. Go to Jodhpur. Bright sunshine you will find in Jodhpur. And all these things, you know, matters because of the rich geology, the richness of the civilization, the rich minerals. We have lead zinc minerals in Jawarmala, copper mineralization in Khetri, very rich mineral deposits, marble mines. The Taj Mahal has been built from Makrana marble. Then Mount Abu Dilwara temple has been built with Makrana Ambaji marbles. Very white, purely crystalline, very coarse grained marbles you will find in Rajasthan. So all these things, you know, has made the geology, the people, the civilization so much rich. So I want you should be also a participant of this richness. So with this, I thank you for your kind attention to my talk.
So Deepak, thank you, sir.
Okay.
Thank you so much. We will start our question and answer session.
Okay.
For 15 minutes.
Okay.
Yeah, because sir is also busy with his work, so we won't disturb him much.
Oh, no problem. Okay, tell me.
Yeah. So participants, whoever has any questions can type it in chat box. The chat box is disabled now. So the question is,
If
Hindoli Aravalli is older than Udaipur Aravalli, so Hindoli group can be grouped with banded Nesik group.
Yes. Yes, it is. Actually, it is part of banded Nesik group only. Because nowadays, people are not calling banded Nesik. It is only one name, Bhilwara supergroup. Within that, your Hindoli is there. Banded Nesiks are there. Mewar Nesik is there. Everything is included in Bhilwara. You are correct. It is equivalent to banded Nesik. But rock is very low grade rocks. Rock is a very low grade rocks. Hindoli is maybe green cyst grade rocks. Garnets are very rare in it. It is not Nesik, but age-wise, it is as old as this Nesik.
Okay. So the next question is, can we consider western basins of Delhi Aravalli Mobile Belt as a back arc basin? And why granulite belts are found only in Proterozoic?
Mm-hmm. See, I'll show you that map. Just a minute. Yeah, it's a good question. Very good question. So what you are asking, on the western part of Delhi, this is the Delhi. On the western part, you have many basins, like Punagad basin, this green color, then Sindret basin. Yes, this could be arc-related basins. Arc-related basins could be Baker or four arc. They are definitely arc-related basins. And second thing you ask, why there is granulites during Proterozoic only? That is what you are asking.
Yes.
It is very important. Granulites, Archean granulites are very rare. It's not unusual, but very rare. But most of the granulites belong to Proterozoic. In Aravallis, you have granulites, Senmata granulites are 1.7. Ombaji granulites is 0.8. You go to Eastern Ghats, it is 1 billion year. You go to South India, they're around 2.5, 2.4. So they're all Proterozoics. The reason is, for granulite metamorphism, you require a thick crust, at least 30, 40 kilometer thick crust. So which was not there during Archean time. Archean time, the crust was thin, around 15 kilometers. So after 2.6 billion years, the crust becomes as thick as 40 kilometers. Because of the thick crust, there was temperature and pressure to develop a granulite belt. So that is the reason. Yeah.
So the next question is, Erinpura granite and Malani granites, what are the implications in terms of neotectonics?
Neotectonics. Okay. So neotectonics, you see, I do not know what you mean by neotectonics. Neotectonics means which occurs during quaternary period. Quaternary period recently. So Erinpura and Malani, they are very old rocks. See, Erinpura has very controversial ages. Some ages are 860 million years. Some edges are there, Mount Abu Granite is 750 million year. So Malani is 750, 760 million year. So these granites are probably developed because of the subduction. Because of the subduction in the arc area, the subduction took place here, Delhi subduction. In the arc area, these granites were entered. So they indicate they are related to the subduction. They are related to this arc formation. So that is one type of tectonics. But if you are asking neotectonic, New tectonic means generally we talk about faulting, the landslide. I do not know. You mean to that, or I do not know.
But I think it's what you have said is the same thing. He must be asking.
Yeah. Okay.
So how we can differentiate charnokite is igneous or metamorphic origin on the field basis?
Yeah, charnokites, as you know, is a granite. It's a granite having hyperstein. That is how a charnokite is petrographically described. But if it is a metamorphic charnokite, then there will be metamorphic fabric. There will be gneissicity, there will be folds, there will be melting, there will be liposomes, there will be paleosomes. Those things will be there in a metamorphic rock. If it is a metamorphic charnokite. If it is an igneous charnokite, it is a homogeneous granite. Homogeneous granite with hyperstins in it. So one is a product of metamorphism, other is a product of magmatism or melt. So both the things you will get in South India. Igneous charnokite, very large protons, granite protons having hyperstein. And there are gneisses where hyperstins are there. Granite gneisses where hyperstins are there. So you call both them as charnokites. So distinct feature is the fabric, rock fabric, metamorphic fabric.
Sir, we'll go to the next question.
Yeah.
Is there any chances of platforms to become a mobile belt? As we know, mobile belts are metamorphosed, deformed, and platforms are undeformed part.
Yeah. Chances means you are talking about future. So in future, it may happen. It may happen. But whatever you see today on the earth crust, you know, some proterozoic rocks has been deformed, metamorphosed, recycled, mobilized. They are your mobile belts. But side by it, you have undeformed, horizontal, stratiform deposits. They are platform. So far, they have not been done. But in future, they can happen. A subduction zone may develop within a platform sequence and just destroy it. So it is quite likely, but so far it has not happened.
So a very good question has been asked.
Yeah.
What is the reason behind calling Aravalli as Pan-African origin, not Rodinia?
Actually, not Aravalli, it is Delhi origin. See, I told you, there are three origins. One is Bhilwara origin, which is 2.6, 2.5. That is the oldest. Then you have 1.7, 1.8. That is your Columbia orogeny, you can say, or Aravalli orogeny. The Delhi orogeny, which is controversial. One is, one group of people are telling this could be Rodinia. The other group is telling it could be Pan-African. Why this controversy is there? Because the deformation and the metamorphism in Delhi and Sirohi is somewhere around 860-800 million. That is the period deformation and metamorphism has taken place. So it does not suit to Rodinia proper. Rodinia is 1 billion year. So 860 and 800 does not fit to that. And Pan-African, most of the areas Pan-African is considered to be 600 to 500 million year. So Delhi orogeny also does not suit to that 600 to 500 million year. But there are some places where Pan-African orogeny is also as old as 900 to 700 million year. There are areas like Arabian-Nubian Shield. So we are comparing our Delhi orogeny with the Arabian-Nubian Shield Pan-African orogeny. That is the point. So that is why it is a little debated or controversial.
I will be asking only the last question. There are around 70 new messages. So we can't go and ask all the 70 new messages.
Okay.
So sir, this is the last one.
Okay.
Those Sangh Mata complexes of 1.7 billion years ago, but it is included in Bilwara supergroup.
Yes.
Why?
See that this occurs in Shenmata. So you see this map, this map cube type of unit. You know, this is Shenmata complex. Shenmata complex. This Shenmata complex has two units. What is a country rock, which is pink color, light pink, and there is another unit which is very dark color. You know, dark color, coffee color. The dark coffee color unit is your granulites, a plutons, small hills. You know, they are the granulites. But the country rock is a gneissic country, banded gneissic, just like your nearby Mangalwad or Bhilwara. So this country rock and this country rock, there is no separation, no difference. Only difference is here you have clusters of granulite plutons. So when they dated this country rock gave 2.8 billion year age, whereas this granulites gave 1.7 billion year. So what they say? So this is part of Bhilwara, but at 1.7 during Aravalli orogeny, these granulites intruded into them. Later intruded them. That is why it is included in Bhilwara, but the age is recent. Age is recent at 1.7 billion.
So there is a very good, interesting question came up from YouTube viewer.
Okay.
The question is, current research suggested that basement Delhi Haridwar Ridge prolonged beyond the MBT, MCT, or even ITSZ. So how we can find such traces in field?
Oh, yeah, people say like that, maybe some geophysical means. See, there is a paper by Zhao who says there is a basin in China where there are Malani type of rocks are there. And Punagarh basin type of sedimentary rocks are there in those China basins. Zhao, paper by Zhao, 2019 he has published. So in those basins, they find rocks like Malanis and this Punagarh. So what do they say? Probably during Neo-Proterozoic time, the Delhi belt was extending to China. So China was very close to India, so it was extending to that. So during Neo-Proterozoic time, there was no Tethys Ocean. So it was a walkthrough. So probably the Haridwar Delhi Ridge, you know, was extending up to China. So now what happened? The rifting took place, Tethys Ocean developed, then Tethys Ocean closed, so much of deformation, metamorphism, granitic intrusion took place. So those Aravalli rocks were lost, you know, within that, because of deformation and metamorphism. But there could be some signature which you can pick up geophysically. Geophysically, you may pick up, which I am not very sure whether that type of work has been done or not. Yes, that is the part.
Thank you, sir, for giving us time. I will call Dr. Nyanada Salvi for a vote of thanks.
Okay.
Hello, Nyanada.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Thank you, Deepak, sir. And hello, Biswal, sir.
Yes.
Good afternoon. Thank you so much, sir. Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Nyanada Sarvi. I'm the assistant professor at K.J. Somaiya College. I'm really honored today to have the opportunity here to thank Biswal, sir, for giving us his time and just talking about Aravallis. You can see how much he loves the field, how much he loves the subject. It's excellent to have been able to listen to him talk about it. So the number of participants itself shows us how much we look forward to your lectures and how impactful they really are. So thank you so much once again for taking the time out of your busy, busy schedule for this lecture for us.
Okay. Thank you so much, Nyada. Actually, you know, through you only, I could meet so many people over this video conferencing. I'm so thankful to you. I'm equally thankful to the participants also for their kind attention. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. So I would actually also like to thank the organizing members. Without their help, this lecture would not have been possible. Handling so many participants at the same time is quite a difficult task. And also, of course, the participants, thank you so much for maintaining decorum during the lecture. We were a large group today. We were 300 people on Zoom and another 300 on YouTube. So thank you so much for all your help in making this lecture a success. Our next lecture will take place on the 7th of August. It's on the igneous petrology subject, and it is being taken by Dr. Raymond Duraiswamy. So we'll send you a link to this lecture very soon. It'll come on the Telegram channel, so keep a lookout for it. And thank you so much once again, everyone.
Okay. So
thank you, Biswal sir.
Okay, we can quit the meeting now, or what is the plan?
Yes.
Okay, fine.